hosted by forensic psychologist Sarah Soderlund and paranormal investigator David Erickson. State of Mind is a show that features mentalism, mystery, and modern psychology with twists of cognitive process and challenges of the mind. News, discoveries, banter, and guests that talk all things fascinating. Join them every Tuesday at 9 p.m. Central, 10 p.m. Eastern, only on ParamaniaRadio.com.
Tune into the Chris and Wayne Show every Thursday night at 8 o'clock on ParamaniaRadio.com. Hop aboard the haunted ship of doom and join Captain Chris.
It was the government secretly outside of the studio.
Skipper Wayne.
I think it's time you get the Kraken out of your butt.
Deck Winch Joe.
Yeah, I got stuck on the corner.
And of course, Cabin Boy Todd.
Oh, look where I'm sitting.
And always remember our motto. Don't just listen to the mayhem. Be a part of it.
Views expressed and the opinions given by the individual hosts and their guests do not necessarily reflect those of Paramania, its affiliates, or its sponsors.
You are listening to Paramania Radio.
Welcome. So it's good morning, good afternoon, good evening, good night, wherever you happen to be in the world. You're listening to Leo Bonomo on Paramania Radio. If you do want to call in, the USA number is 919-295-0150. You can get us on Skype, of course, and you're more than welcome to join in the chat room. I'm sure you all know a gentleman that I've known for a long time, Paul Salmon. And Paul very kindly recommended a lovely lady, Pamela Nine, and an internationally recognised medium and intuitive counsellor. She's an accredited writer, spiritual development educator, owner of Nine Wellness as well. That's located in Knoxville, Tennessee, I think that is TN. I sometimes get these mixed up in the States, and founder of the community organization Spirituality and Health Knoxville. Pamela has had a professional career of more than 30 years and is dedicated to wellness and helping others. She has an international following and has provided service to thousands of people all over the world through counseling, writing, and spiritual apprenticeship program. She describes herself as a natural-born psychic, intuitive, and medium, and her gifts were discovered at the very young age of five, and she's inherited those from her maternal grandmother and several past generations. And she'd began working professionally many years ago, as I've said, and she was guided to use the term intuitive counselling. So there's quite a pedigree there, as you know. Many good mediums have retained this sense of spirit from birth, and that's certainly how Pamela has drawn on those gifts. So very big welcome to you, Pamela. How are you?
Hi, Leo. I'm doing great, and I'm so happy to be here. Thank you very much for having me.
Oh, it's my privilege, and a big thank you to Paul as well, if he's listening. Hopefully he is. He's probably working. We've run into a little bit of what you do, but just take us through a few things. What you saw at the age of five. Did you retain this knowledge from birth, and then it just opened at five, or what happened?
Well, I actually had a really amazing experience when I was five. I grew up on a farm that was my grandparents', and my parents had a parcel of the property, and behind the property we had caverns and ponds and creeks and I loved being outside. So one afternoon, I was outside playing, and I don't know why, but I saw a little snake, and I actually followed the snake into one of the caverns, and it fell in on me. So I was actually buried in the cavern, and I could see slivers of light. And then I actually went to the other side, and I met my spirit guide, which is Native American. My heritage is Cherokee. So I met my spirit guide, and then I met some of my relatives that had previously passed. They were my grandmother's mother and father. So some say I was buried in the cavern for 2 hours, but they really didn't know for sure. And somehow my grandmother and grandfather, he actually figured out where I was, and he dug me out. So after that, I would go to my grandparents' house, and I would tell my grandmother, get out the box of pictures, and then I would tell her things, you know, that I couldn't possibly know about her mom and dad and her grandparents, so she knew at that point that I had her gifts.
Fantastic.
Yeah, then it goes on from there. We actually had a really amazing experience together. I was about 7, and we had an angel appear to us, my grandmother and I, and she told us about, it was her oldest son, which was my uncle, his impending death was supposed to occur in 3 days. Yeah. So this angel, she told us this telepathically, and sure enough, you know, he passed in 3 days, and at the funeral home, you know, he was in the casket, but I could see him walking around the room, and my grandmother said, "You can see him." And I said, "Yes." And then I started seeing colors around people, you know, the aura colors. Yeah. And so it just all kind of, you know, started from there. And it took me a while to, you know, figure all this out and embrace it, but I did.
Yeah. I think the wonderful thing is, because sometimes when people talk to mediums or psychics, and I'm sure you get this, I've had this a few times where it's their first reading, they're very nervous, and they say, "Oh, you're not going to tell me anyone's going to die, are you?" And, you know, there's that kind of aura there. But when we experience things like this, it's actually very calming, isn't it?
It is. It is. You know, and people all the time, "I don't want any bad news." Well, I don't really get bad news to tell people. You know?
Yeah.
I don't know about you, but I don't, you know.
It's quite rare. If I'm talking to a medium and their grandmother or mother is is not well, and they have an intuition themselves something's going to happen, then we'll kind of discuss it, you know, professional to professional. Sometimes when I teach my students, you know, things will come up and we'll discuss it on that basis. But generally, you're not supposed to give that information to others. But they do get quite nervous about it, you know. It's and understandably, I think there are a lot of myths about what we do.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and I think it's wonderful that people like yourself, you know, you can help to dispel those myths and really it brings, spiritualism's a religion. I wouldn't call myself a spiritualist. I would hope I'm spiritual, but if we use spiritualism as a kind of hook to hang things on, it brings it into a better light, you know, so that people can understand the real meaning of it. Because, you know, especially when you get skeptics and that, they want to cloak it in all kinds of stuff. And so it's good the work that you do. You know, we can enlighten people. And I think that's great.
Thank you. And I feel the same about you too, Leo. So I have a lot of admiration, you know, and respect for what you do as well.
Oh, bless you. Just a small cog, you know, but we try, don't we? I'll tell you one thing I found interesting in what you've said there about Cherokee heritage. People that have listened to my show and read my book know that I have an affinity with Jimi Hendrix, and he was a medium as well. And you know, it's more acceptable now. When I discovered it in the early to mid 70s, and first time I heard his music, I knew. He was part Cherokee as well. And Cherokee are known as the Sky People amongst the native Red Indians, aren't they?
Yes, we are.
So I find it interesting that we've got quite a connection. And then you say your you know, Cherokee heritage. I'm thinking Hendrix, Cherokee, fantastic. You must have some fascinating tales to tell about the Sky People.
Oh, I do. And I'm actually working on a book. I've been working on three books for a while. I'm hoping to get one out pretty soon, I hope. Mm-hmm. But the name of the book is called Connecting the Threads. And I was given that, and it's all about these little synchronistic threads that connect people. I mean, it goes into a lot of other things too, but I mean, we just stumbled on one from what you were saying, you know. Yeah. These little threads, they connect everyone. And so, yes, I've had visions my whole life. I was shown a lot of visions when I was in the cavern, and I've seen visions of the Sky People and the Pleiades, and, you know, we could get into a real out there conversation about
we
all
that. We often do on this show. We often do. Yes. It's fascinating, again, to hear you talk of Pleiades and that, because I don't know if you feel this way. I felt this way all my life. When I was very young, I first saw spirit at 2, and it was just natural. And I think, yeah, so what, you know, as you do at that age. But about 1, I felt that I was quite annoyed, because I knew I'd come here for a purpose, didn't really want to be here, and but I'd also known or had a feeling that I had come from the stars as well. Yeah. And from that region, Pleiades. So it's interesting as well that you make that connection, because we're getting a lot of, you know, we went through Indigo Children, Diamond Children, and others. Right. And we've now got Star Seeds, which is a stronger connection to the stars. So it's fascinating as well to hear that aspect of you, you know, and that connection there. So how did you find that passing while you were in the cave?
Ask it again. You cut out just a little bit.
Sorry, I do apologize. What were the feelings like when you were passing, and what you're experiencing? Because so many people, you know, they have this fear, don't they, created by religion?
Oh, I didn't have any fear. It was like, it was the most peaceful, loving feeling that I have ever felt. And I still recognize that feeling within myself a lot of times when I go into a really deep meditation. Mm. And it was just like I was going home. And I still refer to heaven, the other side, that's home. And, you know, honestly, there was a part of me that didn't want to come back. And I've had, yeah. So I've had a couple of near-death experiences, and am not supposed to be here. I was, you know, diagnosed out of here a couple of times, but yet I'm still here. And throughout the experiences that I've had and the visions that I've had, I know, you know, that I'm doing what I'm supposed to do here, and I really do try to honor that. But there is no greater feeling than that passing. And I get that so much with a lot of the spirits that I bring through from the other side, you know, during my readings. And it's just, it's amazing.
It's a wonderful thing, firstly, to have experienced. But you communicate that so well. And I know that that of itself is a great comfort to people, because they often come with all kinds of fears, and sometimes it's fear about a relative that's not well. But, you know, again, we have all these myths, don't we, created by religion and that whips this fear up. So I find, I think it's invaluable. Excuse me, my voice is going. I think it's invaluable that you can transmit that air of calm. And I was going to say compassion. It's not compassion, really, but it's just that sense of security to people. I'm sure you've been told this before, but there's a very, very calming quality to your voice.
Oh, thank you. I do have people tell me that. And, you know, people tell me when they're near me, you know, that I make them feel peaceful and calm them down. And it's so funny. I'll have people come in for readings into my office and they're so nervous and I can feel it. I'm empathic too, you know. So they'll sit down and I'll say, okay, just breathe and you'll calm down in just a minute. And it never fails. I mean, just within a few minutes, they can pick up on me and my energy and they do calm down. So
yeah,
I think we do all possess, you know, an innate healing ability as well as intuitive abilities. And
yeah, I think so. Well, you know, what a lot of people don't realize is that mediums generally do and can heal by talking as well. So there's a great quality there. And I think for people to come in and be immediately at peace like that and relaxed, I think that's a wonderful way to work. Because as you say, no problem. Because it's something that's tangible to them. And, I can see that in itself being quite addictive and a wonderful thing. Okay, if we've got anyone out there that wants to have a short reading with Pamela or wants to pose any questions, etc., USA numbers 919-295-0150, or you can Skype on Paramania Radio or join us in the chat room. So Pamela's quite open to some questions, whatever you want to ask of a spiritual nature, and if you want a reading as well. So there's plenty of time. So if you want to do that, then we certainly can. What's the other books that you're working on?
Well, I'm working on one that is actually my journey, because I have so many wonderful, amazing, even miraculous things that have happened in my life. And it's also a way to teach others how to connect and get centered, you know, within spirit and to develop their own intuitive abilities. So it's kind of a one-stop shop. You get to hear the story and then you get to learn how to do your own.
So that's
one of them. And then, you know, as I said previously, the connecting the threads. And then I have another one that's kind of a surprise, so I'm not gonna let that one out just yet.
Well, I'm sure we'll wait for either of those books, whichever comes first. But you know, you'll certainly be welcome back on the show to advertise the book when it comes out. Not a problem at all. Sorry, go on.
So I do have something really amazing and exciting that has been coming out. It's been coming out over several years, and it's something that I've been working with, and I actually started, I guess, when I was, you know, very young. I had glimpses of it, and so it's been progressively coming out, and it's about raising your frequency, and it's also about remembering and going back into your epigenetic cell memory and recalling, because we all have these experiences that, you know, that seem familiar, or they're, you know, feel like a coincidence, but they're really not. And they're all strands, you know, from previous memories, whether they're lifetimes ago or things that are coming through as carryovers in this lifetime to finish up or to learn or to, you know, to get better acquainted with. So I'm really excited about this.
Yeah, it sounds like a wonderful project. Sometimes these things come up during readings as well, don't they?
They do.
I know people do wonder about their purpose in life and their path, and because it's interesting what you say, that, you know, sometimes, yes, we've got a set of values or things we need to achieve, which we plan for this life, but there is also unfinished business, as you say, from other lives that we need to kind of throw in the mix, and just, you know, while we're here, we'll work it out. It sounds like a fascinating book. Your other book sounds fascinating as well, because it feels like it's part autobiographical and then goes into the swing of it. I know there are so many books on the market written by mediums about developing and the particular way they've developed. But I think with you, your book sounds quite different, as though it's coming at it from another angle. And I think that's really needed. Go on.
You know, it's kind of odd, because there's a lot of people here, you know, they feel guided to get into the psychic work or the mediumship work, and then that's what they do. You know, they seek out a teacher or start reading books. But I didn't have that. You know, my teacher was spirit. I took everything to my creator. And so I feel very honored that I can pass on, you know, the information that I've received. And I think it is unique. And I think it's time to come out. So I look forward to it.
Absolutely. A lot of what, although I did train formally for 8 years, like you, a lot was transmitted directly by spirit. And personally, I think that's the best way, you know, because we can get colored by other teachers. And there's so many that propagate myths, you know, quite strange things. So I think if we can get it more from the source, it's much better. We've got a quick question from Nell, who's a regular to the show, bless her. And she's asked about euthanasia for pets. So, you know, we use this euphemism, don't we, of when they're not well, of putting them to sleep. And her question really is, do spirit consider that murder, or, you know, what's their view on it?
What I get immediately with that is no. If we have a pet that we love and is suffering, we're putting them, you know, out of their suffering through love, and that's not considered murder. That's, you know, that's done through love and to help, you know, your loved one in your pet to cross over, to go home, to be at peace, to be healthy again. And so I think that's seen as a good thing. You know, if it's done for that reason, if it's done because you don't want the pet any longer, or, you know, for other reasons, then it can be dealt with, you know, in a different view, but not done out of love. No.
Yeah. And that's exactly how I feel about it, because, as you know, with spirit, everything's intention. And if it's done with the right intention, then that's what counts. Yeah, it's quite amazing, isn't it? Because certainly, well, in England, we're known as a nation of animal lovers.
Yes.
I do question that sometimes when you see, you know, dog fighting and that kind of thing that goes on. But we're often kinder to pets, aren't we? Because there's a big debate now. Certain countries like Switzerland allow euthanasia, so we can, you know, if we feel we can't carry on, we'll go find these places.
Right.
But we're often kinder to pets in that way than we are to humans, aren't we?
I totally believe that, yes. And so along the same line of the, you know, the question about the pet, I actually had a black wolf hybrid, and I've had a black wolf around me in spirit my whole life.
Oh.
And I ended up with one, you know, in real life.
Mm.
And because of the ordinances in the area that I lived in several years ago, I couldn't keep him, which was a very source of hurt, you know, for me. His name was Shadow. And so he ended up going to another mother, and they lived on property, you know, where he could be. Anyway, he ended up with cancer in his mouth, and they radiated it. And he just got to the point where he was in so much pain, and they actually had him put down. And that was done out of love. And now he's around me in spirit. So I know for a fact that our pets, our loved pets, they still come to us in spirit and are still a part of our lives.
Yeah, I've done many readings where pets have popped up, and sometimes people are quite amazed that you can talk to them, you know.
Oh, I know.
And I explain.
I love it when they come through, don't
yeah.
you?
And they'll often bring up evidence of their lives with them, how they came to them, and how they passed over, you know, whatever the circumstances might be. But that great love as well, as you say, that if they've had to be euthanized, and basically saying it's fine, it's okay, you know, it was understood. So it is a wonderful thing that we can extend to our pets, and rather sad that, you know, we can't extend it to humans. I can't think of anything worse, really, than being locked in a body, racked with pain, and not being able to do anything for yourself. You know, it's a sad, sad situation. We're just going to go into a break. So if anybody does want to call, they can call on the usual number. So it's 919-295-0150, or Skype us on Paramania Radio, or join us in the chat room. You can pose questions if you want a short reading, or just to ask a question directly, then do come through to us. Now we're just going to go on a break, and we'll be back straight after this.
Now on Sunday night at 9 p.m. Eastern, 8 p.m. Central, join host Tim Malley as he brings you the most recognizable names in the paranormal field on Fox City's Paranormal Radio. You know, Brock, I'm a little bummed since Tech Time ended.
Yeah, me too. But you know what we could do to fix this?
What?
A new show.
A new show? About what?
About all things paranormal. Not just technology, but everything.
Brilliant. What would we call it?
Pair Time with Brock and Doc.
Cool. And it could air on Sundays at 10 p.m. Eastern, 7 p.m. Pacific?
Only on the Paramania Radio Network.
Awesome. Welcome to the all-new Paramania Radio.
Don't go by the book. Think like a pirate.
Hi, welcome back. You're listening to Leo Bonomo on Paramania Radio. I've got a wonderful guest, Pamela Nine, internationally recognized professional intuitive counselor and spiritual medium. She's a writer, development teacher, and owner of a couple of businesses, Nine Wellness and Spirituality and Health in Knoxville. And we're just talking about various things. We've got a caller and from the 208 area. So, hi, how are you?
Hi. Hello, I'm good. My name is Darcy.
Name is?
Darcy.
Okay, it just cut out then and I didn't hear it. Welcome, Darcy.
Oh, sorry.
No problem.
I'm calling from Idaho.
Right. Yep. I see that because I see you're from the chat room that you've come through there. So I know you want to talk to Pamela. So Pamela, Darcy, Pamela.
Hi, Darcy.
Hello.
So do you have a specific question?
I'm just wondering if you can pick up, I thought it was an interesting choice of music. They played Van Halen when you had your break, and I have somebody from my past that was very into Van Halen, so I was wondering if you could pick up anything from that.
Okay, someone from your past, huh?
Yeah, somebody I was very close to. They're gone, yes.
Okay. Well, and I'm just going to tell you what I'm getting. I get two people around you in spirit, and I'm not sure if it's because we have David in the chat room, but I get the name David around you. So does that mean anything to you, David? Now, it could be someone that's crossed over, or it can be someone that's still here, but I do get that name around you.
David. The only David I can think of is David Lee Roth.
Okay, well, I do too, but do you have another David? Because I don't think it's David Lee Roth. I know that's connected to the Van Halen, but
to the song, yeah. Not that I can think of. Wow, David.
Yeah, I get David.
Don't get a David. Man, I just can't think of
David. So did you used to work with the David a while ago?
Boy.
because I get him in the work.
I had a friend, David, in high school, but he's still alive.
Okay, well, they don't have to be crossed over. So when I get the name, we have to make a connection to it, and then more information comes. So I get David, and I feel like it has something to do with work or kind of in a work environment. So if you don't make a connection with it, you know, this is something that's still coming. So I want you to hang on to it. Okay. There's a lot of dynamics at work here with the David Lee Roth, Van Halen, and all that. So, and then I get the name Tim around you. Tim.
I did work with a Tim a long, long time ago.
Okay.
Late 80s. Yeah, I worked with a Tim. I haven't seen him since then.
Okay, well, don't be surprised if you have this person pop out of the woodwork or his name comes up somewhere else, because I feel like there's a conversation coming, okay? And I know you're wanting to connect with someone, you know, that has crossed, that's related to the Van Halen, and quite honestly, I'm not getting anything really strong with that. I feel like there's music all around you, and this person was connected to music. I'm not getting a clear, specific name, but was this person, did he play music, or was he in the music field that has crossed?
No, he loved music a lot. I think he wanted to play music. I don't think he ever did.
Okay, so I'm feeling like he connects with you through music. So when you hear things like on the radio, do you feel like, oh my gosh, that's him?
Yes.
He's trying to connect with
you.
Okay, well, I get it. I get a definite yes on that. Okay.
Certain songs, always certain songs, yeah.
Right. And that's how they come through. You know, they do. They connect with us in so many different ways. So I think that's validation of the person that you were wanting to connect with. I'm sorry I can't give you the name, but I get a.
Do you want me to give you a name? Will that help?
No, nope. I don't want you to give me a name. I get a real strong J around you too.
Okay. I know who that is. That's my mother.
Okay. Yes.
She's always there. I've had people tell me that she's always there.
Yes. Okay.
Very much so.
Yes. And you have lots of people around you, and I'll say people, but spirit people around you. So
Darcy, we're just going to fit in. There's a gentleman called Bill that he's got to leave for work in 15 minutes. So we're just going to slot him in here so Pamela can do a reading for him. But if you want to either hang on or call back after the break, so we'll have a break at the top of the hour, and we'll see if I can get anything for you as well. Would that be okay?
Sure.
Bless you, Darcy. You take care.
Okay,
so
you too.
Bye, Darcy.
Bye.
God bless. So hopefully we've got Bill. Hi, Bill. Okay. We're just going to... okay, he can't call in. That's a shame. Okay, he may have had to go rather quickly. Okay, fantastic. We're just going to give out your website for people that want to call in. Sorry, I just got distracted by a message there regarding Bill. Okay, so if you want to get hold of Pamela, it's www.pamela9, that's all one word, so that's PAMELANINE.com. And I've looked at her site. It's a wonderful site, so you can go there and you can make arrangements for readings, etc. Whatever you want to connect to Pamela with. So there's an apprenticeship programs, classes, workshops, So there's plenty there that you can contact Pamela for. So hopefully Darcy will call back at the top of the hour. Apparently Bill was saying that he had to get ready for work in 15 minutes. And he's had to go. So I'm just going to read his question. It says, although I'm uncertain, I'm still in a place for my purpose. I'm also certain that I'm off track of it. So it seems to be on the right path, but deviating slightly. And he's hampered by consequences. The question is concerning whether he's possibly seeking his own forgiveness, and that's what's taken him off track, or the forgiveness of another or others. He seems to feel that's connected with the shame of a loss of status, which is a strange thing to say, actually. How do you feel about that, Pamela?
Okay. So I guess several different things with that. You know how some people are their own worst enemy?
Yeah.
So I think that's what's happening with Bill. I think Bill has a very, very good, loving heart, but he's also, it's like he's too hard on himself sometimes. And I think he's looking in the past at things that he wishes that he could have done differently or should have done differently. And that's hampering his moving forward. So here's my advice. Bill, you need to figure out what you want to do and go for it. Let go of what's been holding you back and see what's out there that you want to go get and go get it. You know, I feel a new career move. I actually feel a move of location taking place. And I think both of these are really good things. It's like he's been in a cycle. And I tell people a lot of times, sometimes if you don't break the cycle's going to break you. And I feel like that's kind of where Bill, he's been kind of running around in a circle. So believe in your dreams and go get them and quit beating yourself up.
Yeah, that's actually something that I've said a lot of times on air and in various publications about that cycle. It's amazing. We again, because we're both working from the source and we have that information, but we also think alike an awful lot. And what I explained to people is exactly what you said. You know, because in life we have several things that we want to experience or the soul wants to experience. And if we deal with it, fine, it's gone. If we try and avoid it or go around it in some way or just not deal with it at all, it does come back in a similar form but harder, and it will keep doing that. And it's very interesting to see that how you work and that you understand that as well. So I do feel that is one of the things that Bill has this problem with. Bill, I would also like to say that I think I might be retracting some of what Pamela says. So if I do, Pamela, I do apologize. But as I'm linking with Bill, I do know that there is some past life connection of not being forgiven and not wanting to forgive others. And I know that in this life, he has a large problem from an early age. I've been taken around to 8 to 10, where he was very loath to forgive something that had been done to him. I do feel this is a family connection as well. And so I do feel that he's having re-experienced that in this life. He finds it very hard to let go. And that is what's holding him back. Bill, I do see you as a very emotional person as well. I do feel there's empathy there, and I know that you're struggling with a spiritual track. And when we're sensitive, and if we don't have a fuller understanding, we tend to see things that happen around us or everything as being a sign of some sort, and it can cause a lot of contradictions. And I think that because you are empathic, I think that you're looking for signs. Honestly, Bill, I think you need to let go of the past, because there's a great deal of that and looking back, but you have to just relax a little, just step back and not see every little thing as a sign. If you can, let us know at some point, so we can just get some feedback. And if you can phone into the show next week, we can kind of discuss that as well. And obviously, we'll let Pamela know. But I think that's what it is. I think you're very unsure. You're not willing to forgive yourself mainly. And there's this struggle to find out where you are, and you're seeing everything as a sign. You need to relax a little bit, Bill. So hopefully that's helped you. Okay.
I think that's beautiful. And yes, I think you hit it right on. Honestly, that was beautiful.
Oh, bless you. Thank you. I'm just reading here that you received a coveted Extraordinary Woman Award for your talents as a messenger of spirit. Tell us a little bit about that, when you got it, and how did they find you?
Well, you know, it was actually given to me by the New Sentinel here in Knoxville, where I live. People had written in all kinds of testimonials about coming to see me and different things that I'd helped them with. And I was given the Extraordinary Woman Award, and I think it was 2002. It's been many years ago, but it's always been very special to me, you know. So
It's always nice to get recognition, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yes. Talking of recognition, Bill is texted in for you, and he says, yeah, I get this completely. So it's nice. I can just see him
validation.
Trying to get, absolutely. I can just see him trying to get ready there and think, oh, I'll just do this before I go. Bless him. Again, it is nice to have the recognition of your peers, isn't it? But I know from talking to you that you're one of these that doesn't have ego. I think that's really, really important. There are, I think, too many who either it is a business. I'll refer to it as a business, although it's not really a career, is it? That word's gone. I was going. What is it? Oh God, it's gone. It'll come back to me. So sometimes people are drawn into this for the wrong reasons. I know.
Agree. Yes.
Yeah.
It's funny, and I don't want to interrupt, but this just came to mind. I have this little. It's a little comic strip picture, and there's a gentleman standing in front of a whole bunch of books, and it says self-help. Okay, well, he's standing there by himself, and then another part of the picture, there's a whole bunch of people all jumbled around the sign, and above it says fixing others. So I have to laugh at that. I really do.
I like that image. Yeah, what I was... whilst you were talking there, Spirit just came in and gave me the word that I wanted, which is great. Yeah, because for us, it's not a career, it's a vocation, isn't it? But I think so many people come into this again with illusions that, oh, it's going to be great. You know, I'm going to go on stage, I'm going to have fame and money and that, and completely the wrong idea. And I think it's wonderful that you don't have ego, because it's something that really needs to be controlled.
Well, it is, you know, and I have a lot of clients, you know, and you have clients sometimes they're, you know, and I'm not putting anyone down. I don't do that. But, you know, I know for a fact that there are a lot of people that go see a lot of different psychics and mediums. Mm-hmm. And, yeah, you know, and quite honestly, some of the psychic mediums out there, and again, people can do their own thing and I'll do mine, but they charge astronomical rates. And, yeah, you know, and then the messages that are given are very vague or general. And, you know, it's almost like people don't need to wake up one day or have an experience and say, oh, I'm going to be a psychic tomorrow and charge tons of money and blah, blah, blah. I mean, I believe that spirit chooses you. And, yeah, you know, you come into this life doing what you're supposed to do here. And I know this is what I'm supposed to do. And, you know, yes, although I am humble with it, I am very confident in what I do. And, you know, and I just...
There's a big difference, isn't there, between confident and ego. And yeah, I agree with you 100% there. I think society sometimes is to blame for this. You know, Andy Warhol said everyone will get their 15 minutes of fame. I think the world takes that literally now. And you can see from some of the programs, I don't know whether you get a program called Big Brother made here in England, but I'm sure there's similar things in the States. And people are now famous for being famous. And that's it.
It's
no
hilarious.
Talent or anything. But they seem to want to demand that they are noticed. And it's a little bit like saying, you know, I was born, you owe me a living. The only thing that is owed is a pass into spirit. The rest we have to work for. But you do get these, you know, and think, well, you know, I'm famous, pay attention. And one of the ways that they do that, because mediumship is really on a high now, is very prominent. And, you know, again, they see people fill in auditoriums and they go, that's what I want to do. They're earning money. And it is for completely the wrong reasons.
It is. It really is. You know, and it, you know, I have an issue with that, because I know my heart is in the right place with what I do. And I'm not saying other people's aren't, but I know what I'm doing is pure and for the right reasons. And yes, I have to pay my bills and all that too.
Of course we do, yeah.
You know, honestly, I give away more than I ever charge for, you know. So.
Oh, bless. It's one of those bones of contention, isn't it? You know, because what's often thrown at us is, well, you know, you have a gift from God, you should give it freely. Well,
right.
So do musicians, so do painters, you know, so do other highly skilled creative people. But you generally don't see them, you know, doing a I'm trying to think of an example, or a best-selling album, and say, right, well, this is my first album. I may never make another one, may never make a cent, but here you go.
Right.
You know, you don't see it, you know, carpenters, yeah, you know, not the group, in case anyone makes that connection, you know, a fabulous carpenter, and say, well, I need you to redo the whole of my house. By the way, I'm not paying you. It doesn't. It only seems to work for mediums and psychics, doesn't it? Yeah, you got a gift. It's free. Yeah, it's it's something we've discussed many times on the show at various points, because I think a lot of it is what skeptics throw at us. But the funny thing is, you know, some of the skeptics like Randy, they're on $100,000 a year. They're paid to be skeptics.
Right.
And they say to us, well, you can't be earning anything because, you know, yeah, whatever.
It's kind of, I don't know. It's, I'm at a loss for word here, but it's just it's just wrong. I'm sorry. It's just wrong.
It is, yeah. I mean, you know, we have to pay bills, and we need to do that in order to work. You know, it's it's a circle, isn't it? You know, and things have changed. In a minute or so, we're just going to go into another break. I think I mentioned it, but Bill come back and just said, he understood completely. So that's wonderful. So if anyone else has got any questions on anything or wants a reading, you can get us on Skype, Paramania Radio. It's all one word. You can find us in the chat room, or you can call in on 919-2950150. If you want a reading or to get in contact with Pamela at all, you can get her on www.pamela9, that's all one word, PamelaAnine.com. So you can contact Pamela there, and we'll be straight back after this.
Hi, I'm Dr. Dave, host of Rockin' with Doc. Come join me to explore the world of music and let it drive your soul. You'll hear songs like... Here I am, rock you like a hurricane. And this... About some classics like this. No matter what you'd like, you'll hear it here. Now on Saturdays and Sundays at 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. Join me every Sunday for the All Song Request Hour, where you, the listener, get to pick your favorite tunes. And Saturday for my weekly themed playlist. Do you want talk radio that is hip, exciting, and has amazing guests?
And it's all about the paranormal. Join Sheena Meadow each week on Tuesdays at 6 p.m. Eastern, 3 p.m. Pacific. You'll want to come play with us at the Haunted Playground.
If you would like to be kept up to date on upcoming show information and events here on Paramania Radio, then please take the time to click on the like button above the chat room to like our Facebook page, and click on follow to follow us on Twitter. Thank you for listening to Paramania Radio.
You are listening to Paramania Radio.
Hi, welcome back to Leo Bonomo on the Paramania Radio. We've got a lovely, lovely guest, great medium here, Pamela Nine. So we've been discussing some of her work, how she got started in this, some of her experiences. So if you want to call in and have a reading or ask a question, then please do. Just before the break, we had, I think it's before the last break, actually. No, it was about 22. Sorry, someone in spirit's correcting me already. We had Darcy on the line, and we cut to give Bill a message from him. So Darcy's back on the line. So, hi, Darcy.
Hello.
Hi. Thanks for holding on. I'm just going to try and get a link with you. Okay, I'm actually seeing you from the shoulders up. So when I see somebody from the shoulders up, it's either the person I'm talking to, which I'm picking up on, or it's somebody definitely alive. If I said that there is a little bit of weight that you carry, I would say your face shape is either oblong or slightly round. I am seeing blonde hair. It's parted in the middle and it's shoulder length.
No, I have very dark hair.
Very dark hair. Okay, so would you understand this lady as being connected to you?
Okay, yeah.
I'm being told that this is the... Bless you. I'm being told that this is a friend. This is a friend that needs help. But would you understand her being quite a proud lady and not wanting to ask for help?
Okay. The person with blonde hair, is that what you mean?
Yeah. Would that make sense to you?
Yes. Yeah, okay. Yes.
I know that she's a friend, but whoever's here, they're standing back. There's nothing sinister in that. But they're saying that do go and be a friend again. I get the feeling that you haven't seen them for a short while. I'm being taken back more or less a couple of months. Would that make sense to you?
Yeah, maybe. I think I saw her like a month ago.
Okay.
But I know she's going through a lot. It's the same person. I know she's going through a lot, so.
Yeah, it is definitely the same person. And what this person here is saying is just go be a friend. Just talk to her. Let her open up. I think there's more of an emotional thing there, really, of her not being able to cope. This is actually a gentleman I can see now. He says she's a very stressful person. She seems to stress about anything and everything, although she has got things she needs to worry about. So would that make sense to her?
Yes.
To you?
Yes. Yes, that makes sense. Yes.
I'm actually being shown her having a problem either carrying bags. I don't think it's a kind of comparison that she's got a whole weight to carry, although I think that's correct. But would you understand that she doesn't seem to be very able to carry shopping, heavy shopping? Would that make sense?
Yes, that makes sense.
Oh, bless you. He's just giving that as a confirmation there, just to say, be a friend. I think it's as much lending an ear as anything else there for you.
Okay.
Have you any questions on her? Because he wants to switch his attention to you now.
Any questions for her?
Yeah, if you've got any questions that have arisen that you want to ask, you don't have to, but otherwise he wants to concentrate on you as well.
Okay. Well, about the only way I could ask a question is if I could tell you what was going on. Do you want me to tell you? Or
If you want to be honest, I always say I don't need
to. Because I don't know how to ask a question if you don't know.
Well, if you're happy with what you've got, tell me, and then this gentleman will chip in.
Okay. Her husband's in a nursing home and he's dying of cirrhosis of the liver.
Right.
And I know that's what she's going through, so I don't know what question to ask because I know that's what's going on, but I guess I don't know how to help her except just go talk to her. I don't
I think this
there
is what the
gentleman... a lot that anybody could do.
Yeah, I think this is why this gentleman said it's more just being an ear for her to talk to. And what you can do is say prayers for her and prayers for her husband. I know you haven't volunteered this, but would you understand, or you may find out, that there was also, there's no finer way to put this really, but there was also a gambling addiction that was there. And so things are not straightforward. They're not straightforward financially for her. Again, that isn't what you can help her with. But if you can tell her of this message, this gentleman's not giving me a name, but he is related to her.
It's probably her father, I would guess.
It may be. Don't tell me if you do. Do you know her husband's name?
Yes.
I'm being given the name H, so it's a H sounding name. This gentleman actually said Harold, but that may just be to emphasize the H. But would that make sense with that with her husband? H?
No.
Okay. I think that's
that might be the gentleman's name. But that's not her husband's name.
I think it is. She would have had an older cousin. And that's the gentleman, and he's on dad's side of the family, he's telling me. Fantastic. Okay. He's switching to you now. He says he's counting out coins, so I know money's a bit tight for you. I think he's being diplomatic with that. Would that make sense to you?
Yes.
Okay. Now, he says he understands that you do the best that you can. He wants you to soldier on through. There is a change coming. He's fanning out banknotes, so I know there's money coming to you. It isn't a lot. It's not life-changing, but then again, $400 at the appropriate time can be life-changing. But there is some money coming back to you. It will make things easier. Would you understand him saying he wants you to give up the idea of moving, if that makes sense?
He wants me to give up the idea of moving?
Yeah. Would that make sense to you?
Yes. I've been wanting to move.
Yeah, this is what he's saying. But he says, look, you know, it doesn't rule it out completely, but there are certain things that you need to go through. Good things. Normally, if I say that, people think, oh, my God, what's going to happen? These are good things, but you need to wait. Take it with a pinch of salt, but he's taking me to April of next year, and he's showing me a new home. Okay. So I think that will happen then. I know you've been waiting for that new home for quite some time, because he's taken me back 4 or 5 years of wishing and hoping. So if you've got any questions, fine. If not, take this gentleman's great love.
Okay. And this gentleman isn't a relative of mine?
This is a cousin of hers on her dad's side of the family. He's actually written 30 for me. I'm taking that with a pinch of salt, but I would say he would have passed away around 30. Quite a heavy set gentleman, broad, heavy set, jet black hair.
I don't know him.
No, she should know him, but she has dark hair as well as you, doesn't she?
My friend?
Yeah.
No, she's the blonde. She's the blonde.
She's the blonde, right.
She's the blonde I'm you were seeing earlier. Yeah.
Right. Okay.
I have dark hair and she's blonde.
Ah, right. Okay. I never remember what I say, there's... if she's blonde, she may be the odd one out in the family, but there you go. Take his great love, honey.
Okay.
All right. God bless.
I have a question not related to that, but...
Quickly, that'd be fine.
Okay. I've had several people say that when somebody dies of suicide, that it's different when they go into the spirit world. Is that true? Or I've had somebody in my family that did that, and then I just had a friend lately that did, and I just don't know what to think about that. I don't know if it's different or.
Pamela and I were talking about this at the start of the show, and we both have a similar view. So, Pamela, would you like to answer this?
Okay. So she cut out just a little bit. Darcy, can you say it again?
I just wondered about when someone goes into a spirit world, someone who's died of suicide. I had a family member that did it years ago, and just lately I had a friend that did. And I've had people tell me that it's different when someone dies from suicide. Is that true, or...
Well, so here's what I've been given, you know, all these years I've been doing this. So we all go to heaven, okay? And there are different levels in heaven. And depending on, you know, your choices, the things you do when you're here, the level of spiritual evolution that you attain while you're here, that determines the level that you go to. So if you've committed suicide, yes, you go to heaven, okay? But you go to a different level than you would, you know, if you hadn't committed suicide and you had lived out your life path and, you know, done the things that you were destined to do here. So the energy does come through a little differently. And I honestly can say all these years doing this, every time I get someone that has committed suicide, the first thing they come through and say is, I'm so sorry for what I put my family, my friends, my loved ones through. I wish I had made a better choice. So, and then I have people, you know, honestly, I have clients, they've lost someone that they love dearly, and, you know, they think about committing suicide. Well, I'm here to tell you, you don't go to the same place. You won't get there. So,
yeah,
you know, always, absolutely. So they're there. They're just in a little different place, and they attain spiritual evolution on the other side instead of gaining it here. So it's not like they've, you know, created a, you know, something that they can't work through, because we do gain spiritual evolution on the other side as well.
So are they easier or harder to pick up for you or not? Is it the same?
No, it's about the same. It's a little different energy, and I immediately, you know, get that, you know, see, I'm empathic, and so I actually can feel other people's emotions and feelings. And then when spirits come through to me, I can, a lot of times they will show me or have me feel what took them, you know, or what they experienced here. So I get it, you know, in a lot of different ways.
Okay. And with spirit, Darcy, so much is the intention, you know. So if they pass because they were truly mentally ill, then they would be treated slightly differently. But, you know, so try not to worry about that.
Right. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Just say prayers
for
them, honey.
Yeah, it just seems so rough. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, you know, to do that, usually it's a big decision, does take courage, but it's people find they're under tremendous pressure. And to be honest with you, we're never given a task we can't complete. So more pressure than we can. But obviously some people feel that that pressure is far too much. So I would say prayers for them as well and ask for healing. You take care, Darcy. God bless.
Okay, thank you so much.
Bye, Darcy. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Okay, we've got another caller from 865 area. Hi, who's this?
This is Darlene.
Hi, Doreen. How are you?
Darlene.
Oh, Darlene, I'm not only is my memory playing up, my ears are playing up as well tonight. It's not going to be a good night. I do apologise.
Okay.
we've got. sorry, I've got someone in spirit in here, just making me laugh. We've got Pamela here for you. So, Pamela, far away, darling.
Hi, Darlene. So
hello, Pamela.
So you're in 865. So you're in Tennessee. So
yes, I'm in Strawberry Plain.
Are you
Strawberry Plain?
Okay.
You know where that's at?
I do. So, what is your question? Do you have a specific question?
I do. I retired last year, and I'm not real happy being retired. So I just wondered, I'm kind of a young retiree. Do you see anything in my future? I'm just kind of looking to see what it is. You know, I've always been in the field of business and education, and so I'm looking for something different. I was wondering if you could give me any direction. I just kind of feel a little bit lost. I lost my husband. He died a couple of years ago. I'm just kind of don't know where to go and what to do or whatever.
Okay. So you said you're in education. I get numbers and books all around you. And I feel like this is something, were you in this field for many years? I feel like this was, you know, a long career path. Is
30,
that true?
30 years.
30. Okay, good. Okay. So, and the funny thing is, I don't really see you getting back into that. I feel like you're going back into a business field, but it's more on a part-time basis. And I get something about, and I get numbers again, and it almost feels like you're in some kind of corporate business that you're helping, and I don't want to say financial planning, but you're in something with the financial end of a large corporate business, like helping something, you're launching something new, you're helping something new that's coming into play. And this is, I feel like you've been looking in different areas about which direction to go. Okay. So this is a new area, and I really feel like it's going to be something that's just going to open up and be shown to you. And the crazy thing, I keep hearing something about insurance, and I think you're going to be offered something to do with an insurance type position, but I think you're going to say no So, you know, you'll have to get on my website and maybe send me a message, you know, and let me know how that works out. So just keep moving forward. I feel like there's definitely something opening up within the next few months. And you mentioned your husband passed, and I get a real strong J around you. And this is
his name was Jimmy.
Jimmy, okay, okay. Well, there's your J. And I get the color. He keeps showing me a red ball. Does that make any sense? Like a big red ball? Does that make any sense whatsoever?
It does. We always kept a big red ball in our backyard for our grandson to play with. He was like 2 and 3 years old.
There
was always
serious?
A red ball. We played kickball with him in the backyard. Yes.
Okay. Okay. So he keeps showing me that, and he's very happy. He feels like to me that he finally found the peace that he could not capture here. It was like he struggled with health issues for a long time before he passed. Is that correct?
Yes, it is.
Okay. Okay. So I really feel like you're in a good place right now, Darlene. I think you just need to really sit down and get centered and ask Spirit which direction you should go in and meditate, pray about it, and let those
right.
doors open up. I really feel like that would be great. So I want to ask, Leo, how do you have anything that comes through with this? What do you get?
I get broadly similar. I think you need to, again, think about what it is that you do. I think if you widen your scope and just allow something to come through, anything. I know that you're a very intelligent woman. I know that you have a very logical mind, but you can think outside the box. Would that make sense? Or that makes sense to you?
Yes.
Okay. And I'm not sure, as I've said, I'm not sure. I've got a lady step through. She's a big frame. She says she had blonde hair, but I can see it as white. There is a slight bit of white underneath the chin. I'm notoriously bad with ages, but this lady would have passed between late 60s, late 70s. When
grandmother,
she was on.
Grandmother.
Right. Fantastic. She wants to say to you that, if I said her passing was more sudden than could be expected, would that make sense?
Yes, it was. She was in her early 60s.
Early 60s. Okay. Well, I have been 20 years out before now with them, but 30 years is a record even for me, I think. Okay. Because she was talking about that passing, and she wants you to know that you will find she said enjoyment in employment, which rhymes. Would you know whether she had a love for poetry?
No, I really didn't know that she did or not.
Okay, it's just a strange way to put it, and Spirit never say anything by coincidence, but she rhymed the two, enjoyment with employment. But I know that you'll find something that you like. She says if it's a little, she says off the road. I don't know whether that's a term you would use, but I would say offbeat. If it's a little off the road, then she says, actually, that's what you want, because you don't like the normality that life can bring. You need something to capture your imagination. Would that make sense as well?
Yes, and I've been wanting something fun because, you know, I spent 30 years in education and 10 years in business before that. And so I'd really like to have something that's just kind of fun to do, you know.
Yeah, I think this is why she's saying just broaden that horizon a bit, be open to something coming. But I know that will happen for you. She's actually called out happy birthday. She's not pointing at you. She's pointing over your shoulder. So there's someone very close to you that she says is Mr. Birthday. So we're going back a couple of weeks. Does that make any sense?
Mr. Birthday.
Yeah, so I think either people didn't acknowledge her birthday. This is a lady because I wanted to say her. Or she's just thought, you know what, I'm not going to bother. So she's kind of missed a birthday in that sense. Would you understand that?
My grandfather's birthday is coming up July 28th.
I feel like there was a birthday that happened recently that she's trying to recognize.
Yeah, okay. I think it is.
I have several nieces and nephews who have birthdays in July.
Right. Would you understand the name of Rita?
I'm sorry?
Would you understand the name of Rita, and it's somebody on Earth?
Reed?
Rita, R-I-T-A.
Oh, Rita. I have a cousin named Rita.
Right. It's just been given as a confirmation. So there's a birthday that someone either didn't celebrate, and it's just gone. I'm sure it'll come to mind.
It might have been Rita's birthday. Yes, I bet. Yes.
Ah, okay. Thank you for that. Bless you. Anything you want to add, Pamela?
I get her grandmother very, very strong around her. I feel like at this point in your life, Darlene, you're actually opening up your own intuitive abilities. And I feel like that there's going to be a lot of movement with that. And so I want you to really pay attention to, you know, the signs that are showing up in your life. Are you getting signs that you feel like come from your loved ones in spirit, like your husband that passed or your grandmother? Also get mom around you in spirit too. So has your mother passed?
2 years ago, my mother passed 6 months after my husband.
Okay. Well, I feel like your mother and your husband are keeping company in heaven. So do you feel like you're actually getting signs and, messages from him?
I think that he's here or he's alive, and then I wake up.
Okay.
But I don't corn, anything like that, but and sometimes I just kind of feel, you know?
Well, I feel like I'm being guided to tell you to pay more attention and to really open up to the, you know, all the signs that are going to be coming to you. You know, a lot of times we get signs and, you know, we're staring right at them and then it's like, oh, I wish I get a sign, you know. So I do that all the time. But I think you're getting ready to go through another huge transition in your life in a big way. I think it's your time, honey. I really do. So look forward to it.
I appreciate that. Because, like I said, I do feel kind of lost, heartbroken, you know, lost sometimes.
Mm. Yeah. I think Pamela's right. I think you're ready to develop. Pamela, I don't know whether you do development at home.
I do. So, Darlene, why don't you, you know,
Darlene lives about 20 minutes from you, I'm told.
Right.
20 minutes drive, yeah.
Okay. So, if you're interested, go on my website and I offer a spiritual apprenticeship program where we actually work one-on-one together. And so see if that's something you think you'd be interested in. I work with people all over the world, you know, on the phone or in person. And I really think that could, you know, benefit you. But also, you know, it has to feel right for you. And if you have questions about it, just call in, and or we can set up a time for you to come in, and I'd love to meet you. So just let me know.
Okay, great. I appreciate it so much. Thank you both so much.
Bless you, darling. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
Goodbye.
Goodbye.
Bye, darling.
Bye-bye. Bye. Thank you.
Okay. Bless you, honey. Take care. Okay, we're just going to go into a break, and we'll be straight back after this.
Hey guys, I got the perfect song for the show. What do you think about this?
What the hell is this?
Dude, this is not the boring psychic.
Oh, okay, how about this instead?
Take out the papers and the trash.
This is an error.
Or you don't get no spending cash.
No. This is what I'm talking about.
Yeah!
The party is live every Friday night, 7 p.m. Eastern, 4 p.m. Pacific, with a twist of metal. Melissa Bruce is the heavy metal psychic.
Only on Paramania Radio. Be there.
Have you ever wondered what's behind the open door?
Mm-hmm.
Then tune in with hosts Maggie Renee and Vicky Johns every Wednesday at 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. Only on the Paramania Radio Network.
Welcome to the all-new Paramania Radio.
Don't go by the book. Think like a pirate.
Hi, welcome back. You're listening to Leo Bonomo on Voice of Spirit Paramania Radio Show. Got a wonderful guest tonight, Pamela Nine. And if you've missed the show, you've come in late, you can find it on archive, of course, along with other programs. Pamela and I were talking in the break there because I asked her where the nine comes from, making a little joke about, you know, it's like when you open an email when it's you know it's Jeff 9261 because that's the only one you've got left. But there's a fascinating story behind your name, isn't there?
Well, so the nine is actually my maiden name. I was born a nine this time, you know, and I've done lots and lots of research on that, and there's just phenomenal information about the number nine. The nine is the number of finality. It's there are nine spiritual gifts. You know, the nine is blah, blah, blah. I mean, it's just on and on and on. So I knew, I guess I knew early on that, you know, I had a big package to deal with, you know, this time around.
Yeah, so it's I mean, obviously nine is connected to numerology as well, so right. Is nine as the number as we understand it, or is it a Cherokee connection? Because there's a Cherokee connection with you as well, isn't there?
Well, the nine comes from my father's side, which is actually in, you know, German, which nine is.
I was going to say
no.
Nine. Yeah.
No. And the funny thing is, I've actually been doing some genealogy research, and I have found out some amazing things from my ancestry. And, you know, I'll bring this all out, you know, in time. But it's kind of my little funny story about my name. When I signed up on Facebook, you know, with this was back in 2009, actually. So I signed up, and they wouldn't let me have my name because they kept saying it wasn't
a real one.
Right. And so, you know, finally, I had to send my driver's license and all kinds of ID to finally get my name. And then I did a little joke. I said I probably should have asked for Pamela 8. Maybe I would have gotten that one. Yeah.
I think that's fascinating. I had slightly thought, actually, nine is that the way it's written, is that a corruption of the German? But it's to be honest, it didn't quite feel right, and I thought it was just my mind playing tricks there. But yeah, that's a wonderful thing. And are you in numerology terms a nine?
No, numerology. My life path is 11, so it's one of the master numbers. So
yeah, yes. Yeah. Because in numerology as well, obviously the letters have a particular sum, and then you can add those up. And I was just thinking, I'm not quick enough. When I'm working, I can't add up because I'm in a different state. I was trying to think, Pamela 9, what does it add up to? But that's way past me.
yeah, I have to get my calculator.
Absolutely. We were talking earlier about it was lightly touched on your sort of Cherokee heritage, and you also spoke about a wolf in spirit, which would be a power animal in shamanic terms. But it was interesting to hear you talk of, I think you said it was a mixed breed, but had wolf in it, a dog called Shadow. And what really struck me, if you can confirm, is that I get the feeling, and I've never known this before, that either the power animal or a part of it incarnated. And so would that make sense to you?
Oh, absolutely. So if you'll remember the story that I told about when I was in the cavern and I was buried. So yeah. I actually had a black wolf there with me. And then I would have a black wolf with me. I mean, I had a black wolf with me in spirit my whole life. I would dream about them. I would run with them. I would have visions of them. And they even showed up. I mean, crazy things would happen before my shadow actually came forward. So, gosh, I can't remember when it was. I'm thinking like 2001. I was at my office really, really late. And so I was driving home. And all of a sudden, I saw what looked like a big black wolf or a big black dog run in front of my van. So I slowed down. Mm. And, you know, my heart was pounding. And I'm like, oh, my God, what's going on? Because I get signs all the time. And so right there in front of me, it had been raining. And there was a huge cavern-like place in the road that had been washed out. And if I hadn't stopped, I mean, I could have flipped my van or been killed or had a great, you know, horrendous accident.
Yeah.
So I've had spirit show up in the wolf form, you know, my whole life. And then my son, he said, Mom, I want to get a dog, you know. Actually, he wanted an iguana. Okay. And so he sends, this is funny, he sends me on this website. And so I'm looking at the iguana and I'm going, I don't think so. And so he said, well, okay, so maybe let's get a dog. So on this website, there was this, I could see this little tiny black puppy and it had a red bow around its neck. And it said, Shadow. Okay, well, I have a great connection to the name Shadow because my oldest son, we used to, that was one of the movies, what was the name of it? The Long Journey Home with the dog Shadow.
Oh, right, yeah.
Yeah, so he actually had a stuffed dog that he named Shadow and he loved off the fur and I used to read The Velveteen Rabbit and all that. So there was a great connection to the name Shadow. So there was energy all around that picture. And so I clicked on it and I fell in love. And it was a wolf hybrid. It was the parents were named Zeus and Tala and they were timber wolves. And they had just
big, aren't they?
Yes. And they had one of them had just a little bit of Siberian husky, so it made it not a full blooded wolf, but called a wolf hybrid. And I fell so in love with that dog. I hand-fed it. You know, it was such a tremendous connection. And yes, I believe with everything I am that my wolf totem in spirit manifested in reality in real life. So,
yeah.
Yes. And so I have him in spirit with me again. Because, you know, he passed. And so it's like it went full circle.
I think that's wonderful. I had a feeling that there was more than just that shamanic connection. As soon as you mentioned it, I thought it physically incarnated. I've got to say, in I saw spirit when I was two, so I've seen spirit for 58 years. I have never known of that before. Now you've said it, I think, well, why not? You know, spirit could do all kinds of it. But not only have I never heard of it before, the notion of that happening, of a power animal incarnating, not even the notion of that was there. So I learn something every day, and I'm blessed to have learned that, because that's now opened up a whole new avenue of exploration for me. So I think it's wonderful.
Thank you.
No, thank you. It's I've really, really learned something. Okay, now we've got about eight minutes to go. So if you wanted a reading with Pamela and you haven't been able to, you can get her on www.pamela9.com. Pamela9.com. So you can find out what she does there, as well as being an intuitive counselor, medium. She's an educator, a writer. She does an apprenticeship program. So if there's anything you want to know about her, then fantastic. You can get her on that site. Okay. Right. Do you take part in shamanic rituals, you know, Cherokee rituals?
You know, I do. My grandmother taught me some of my, you know, my Cherokee heritage. And then I was guided to, well, my spirit guide is Cherokee. And so I've been guided through that my whole life. And, you know, I use herbs. I have practices that it's just a regular part of my life. And I include that in my apprenticeship program, you know, for those that applies to. And it's a part of who I am. And I honor that and feel very blessed to have it.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's a great shame, you know, the way America developed before, because everyone knows that there are lots and lots and lots of Native American Indians that are guides, and that's no surprise, because very, very spiritual people. I've said on the show before that they lived the right way. You know, they took what they needed. They didn't hoard. They blessed their food when they killed it to eat. And that they truly, truly lived with the land. I know Aboriginals do. I know sometimes the Maori do. And there are various tribes that live very close to Mother Earth. But I think as a huge, great nation, I think the Indian nation has been very much misunderstood through the early years when, you know, I was going to say when America was modernized, but I think in many ways actually went backwards. And I might not be liked for saying that, but, you know, so because I think a great heritage was lost there, you know, in the way that we should treat the land and understand it, because it speaks to us, doesn't it?
Oh, it does. And I have a great connection to the earth and, you know, the moon. And I honor that and practice that, you know, in my everyday life. And it's the right way. You know, of course, that's my opinion, but, you know, that feels right to me.
Oh. Yeah, I would agree 100% with that. I know that since the Industrial Revolution, man as a species We've tended to lose so much connection with the earth. We've not been intelligent about it. I think materialism grew up certainly during the Industrial Revolution. Things took off in different ways, which may have seemed novel, but I think unfortunately it grew in popularity. And you know, there's always been money, you know, and rich people, however far back in history you go, there's always been some sense of some being above others in that sense. But since that, I think we really, really lost our way. I think it would be nice if we could go back to those ways, certainly in practices. And I do think that's happening.
Oh, I think it is happening in a lot of ways. I do.
Yeah, I think so too. We've just had Nell back on, okay. And she says, "Can Pamela talk about power animals, please? We've got about 3 or 4 minutes." So
okay. Yes, power animals. I refer to them as animal totems. We all have them. The animals show up in our lives to teach us medicine, to give us medicine, to help us on our paths. For example, if you have a hawk that shows up, hawks are messengers. Pay attention to the message. There are so many different power animals. Rabbits. I have rabbits show up all the time. It's funny. Rabbits symbolize a transformation, like a new cycle that's beginning, a 28-day cycle. And I'll tell you what, there's an amazing book by Ted Andrews that's called Animal Speak. And it talks about the animal totems and the medicine that they bring. It's kind of like a reference book, and I highly, highly recommend that. So, you know, for others that are interested, I would suggest that.
That sounds fascinating. I know that some of our so-called fairy tales are inspiration from spirit. As you know, Pamela, there are whole worlds that are occupied just by children for all different kinds of reasons, and they do have what we believe are fairy tales, you know, shortbread cottages and that kind of thing. And I know that that's been transmitted to people. They've picked it up mediumship wise and written these wonderful books, you know. Mm-hmm. But I also know that the origin of Dr. Doolittle and speaking to the animals comes from that spiritual understanding that everything in spirit talks to us. It's all telepathic.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah, whether it's water, trees, whatever it might be. So there are lots of fascinating connections between what some may feel are inanimate objects or just animals, or you know, it's just a tree and that. Everything has life, doesn't it? Everything has
energy. Oh, it does. My goodness, we need to have a show about that. I mean, I can tell you all kinds of stories.
That would be wonderful.
Yes, I work with the water spirits, the thunder spirits, and I communicate with animals. And it's just amazing once you finally realize we really are all connected, you know. Mm-hmm. And again, there's my book title, Connecting the Threads. I love that. But we are. And once you recognize that, life takes on a whole new meaning. And that's what I'm here to do.
Yeah, absolutely. And again, I think, you know, when you're born for it and you realize it and understand, I don't think there's any other path that you can take.
No,
you know, it's I think mine are kind of wavered in and out at some point. But then, you know, spirit sometimes, because they can be thick. And if you're not taking the hint, spirit go, right, we're taking it out of your hands. Right. Not that they're taking away free will, because obviously I came here for that, so that was the purpose, but they kind of give you a slap around the head.
Yeah, it's like, hello, get
exactly,
back over
yeah.
here.
Yeah. Okay, right. The show's over. It's gone far too quick, so if you've enjoyed it, go to see www.pamela9.com we have to go. It's been an absolute privilege talking to you.
Thank you. I really, really enjoyed it.
Bless you.